Hello everyone, my name is Anita, USRN. Today we'll be discussing and practicing few questions and answers, especially related to fundamental of nursing and some other general questions. I have a special gift for you all, that is NCLEX related resources and online classes that few students will be getting who are subscribed to my channel. And you also have to fill the form given in the description box below. So please fill the form and subscribe my channel and be lucky one to get all the resources and online classes. Now let's go through the situation. Situation 1. Which positions are correct when caring for the client undergoing therapeutic procedures? So this is SATA questions. Let's see the options. Option 1. Supine position after lumbar puncture. Option 2. Sims position for substitute enema administration. Option 3. Left side after liver biopsy in hepatitis. Option 4. High Fowler's for paracentesis in cirrhosis. You can pause the video and guess the answer. So the correct options are option 1, option 2, and option 4. Now let's see why these options are correct. So for lumbar puncture, patients should be kept in fetal positions or bent over a table to separate the vertebra. This is during the procedure, because if the patient is kept in such position, then it helps to separate the vertebra and it becomes easier for puncturing the needle and obtaining the CSF fluid or the sample. However, post-procedure, we need to keep the patient straight. The spinal cord should be straight. It is because it helps to prevent the leakage of CSF fluid and thereby it prevents from spinal headache. So, patients should be kept for about 4 to 8 hours in such position. So, this is the correct option. Option 2, positioning the patient in left side sims left recommend position for substitute enema. This is the correct option because while we are administrating enema to the patient, we need to keep the patient in left lateral position. So in this position, patient's left leg is straight while right knee and hip is fixed. So this becomes very easy for nurse to insert the enema and it enables easy passes of fluid into the anal canal or the rectum. So this is the correct option. Option 3 talks about liver biopsy position. So during the biopsy, the position of the patient should be supine with right hand above the head. So this facilitates easy obtaining of the sample. However, post-procedure, patients should be kept in spine right side position for about 12 to 14 hours because after the biopsy, there is high chance of bleeding and hemorrhage because liver plays role in coagulation, and so there is high chance of bleeding after the biopsy of liver. It compresses the great blood vessels and thereby prevents the hemorrhage or reduces the risk of hemorrhage. So it is for this reason patient is kept in right spine position for about certain period of time after doing the liver biopsy. So this is incorrect option because it talks about keeping the patient in left side after the liver biopsy, but the patient should be kept in right side. So option 4 talks about high Fowler's position for paracentesis in cirrhosis of liver. So this is because for paracentesis, if a patient is kept in a high Fowler position, then it helps to drain the fluid down because of which it helps for ED passes or ED drainage when trocar is placed. So it is for this reason patient is kept in a high Fowler position. So this is the correct option. Let's see the second situation. Situation 2. The nurse is preparing to insert a Salim-Som NG tube as ordered in the patient with a diagnosis of ruled out intestinal obstruction. In which position should the nurse place this patient during the procedure? Option 1, head of the bed elevated 30 to 45 degree. Option 2, head of the bed elevated 60 to 90 degree. Option 3, side lying with head of the bed elevated 15 degree. Option 4, lying flat with head turned to left side. You can pause the video and guess the answer. So the correct option is head of the bed elevated 60 to 90 degree. So why this is the correct option? Because if head of the bed is elevated 60 to 90 degree, it facilitates swallowing and movement of tube through GI tract. So it enables easy passage of tube. So this is for this reason patient is kept at this height. However, other option includes head of the bed to be elevated 30 to 45 degree. This is too low for this procedure. And option 3 talks about side lying. This is not the proper position for inserting NG tube. And side lying flat, head turned to the left side. This is also not the appropriate option. So these options are excluded. So it should be in 60 to 90 degree for easy passage of tube. Situation 3. Patient is under continuous enteral feeding. What does nurse take into consideration while providing the feeding? So option 1, hanging a full day's worth of formula at one time. Option 2, positioning the patient on left side. Option 3, elevating the head of the bed. Option 4, warming the formula before administrating. You can guess the answer. Correct option includes option 3. So why this option is correct? Let's have a look. Because lying prone or supine during the feeding increases the risk of aspiration, and therefore, while clinically possible, the patient should be placed in an upright position. Keeping patient in upright position reduces the risk of aspiration. So there are some clinical situations when upright positions are contraindicated. So in such situation, patient should be positioned on the right side, because this also reduces the risk of aspiration. Option 1 talks about hanging full day's worth of formula at one time. This is not applicable, because hanging fluid for a long period of time increases the risk of microbial growth. The nurse should give enteral feeding at room temperature, because this minimizes the GI distress. Because if the fluid is too warm, then it is not good for the patient, and even if it's too cold, it causes distress in the patient. So the fluid should be given at the room temperature. Let's see the next situation. Situation 4. The nurse is preparing to infuse 2 units of packed red blood cells. Which action should the nurse take? This is select all that apply question. So the options are assess patient's vital sign. Option 2, administer both units simultaneously. Option 3, obtain white tubing and prime with NS. Option 4, monitor the patient continuously for 15 minutes. Option 5, set the infusion pump to deliver the unit over 50 to 60 minutes. Option 4, spike filtered intravenous tubing with 5% extrude solution. So the correct options are, it's already given here. It's option 1, 3 and 4. That is, we should assess patient's vital signs and obtain white tubing set and prime with NS and monitor patient continuously for 15 minutes. So let's see why these options are correct and why others are not. Prepare the white tubing with normal saline and have the blood ready in an infusion form. So the normal saline is just used to prime the tubings. So this is the case. So after administrating the blood products, we should check vital signs continuously for about 15 minutes. It is because there is high chance of blood transfusion reaction within first 15 minutes. So we should observe for symptoms or signs for this transfusion reaction, and we should regularly monitor vital signs. So we should observe for any allergic reactions or any fever or graft-versus-host disease conditions or transfusion-related acute lung injury. So we should observe signs and symptoms for transfusion reaction for first 15 minutes. And it is because in this period of time, there is high chance of occurrence of transfusion reactions. However, even after this time frame, we need to continuously monitor the patient, but not as often as in the beginning of the transfusion. Even after the first 15 minutes, we should run the blood product slowly. And in first 15 minutes, it's just about 2 ml per hour or 120 cc per hour. So if we infuse blood product too fast, then there is chance of occurrence of allergic reactions or transfusion reactions, and there is also the chance of fluid volume overloads. So it is not advisable to infuse blood product within very short period of time, that may be within 50 to 60 minutes. So this is not advisable for this reason. So this option is excluded. And we don't use dextrose for priming the tube. So we use normal saline for priming this tube. So we need to prime the tube and keep aside. Let's see the next situation. Situation 5. A postoperative client is receiving continuous bladder irrigation of estradiol normal saline at 150 ml per hour. The nurse empties urine drains back for a total of 2000 ml at the end of the 8-hour shift. How many milliliter does the nurse documents as the total urine output? So we need to calculate the amount of urine output that the patient has passed in 8-hour time period. So for this, the total amount of irrigation solution infused into the bladder is 150 ml per hour. So within the 8-hour shifts, it is 1200 ml. That is because this is 150 ml is for 1 hour. So for 8 hours, we need to multiply it by 8. So 150 multiplied by 8 equals 1200 ml. So this is total amount of drainage fluid infused to the patient within 8 hours. Now the total amount of urine output is equals to total amount of drainage in the bag, means the drainage that is collected at the end of the shift, that is 2000 ml. This includes both urine and drainage fluid. So this is total amount of fluid that is drained out in the bag, that is 2000 ml. 2000 ml that includes drainage fluid as well as urine of the patient. And we have total amount of irrigation solution infused is 1200 ml. So we need to exclude this fluid, amount of fluid infused to the patient. Then we'll get total amount of urine output, that is 2000 total amount of drainage and 1200 ml, that is total amount of fluid infused to the patient. So if you subtract 2000 ml and 1200 ml, we'll get 800 ml. That is total amount of urine that the patient has passed within the 8 hour. 800 ml is the correct answer. Now, I'd like to discuss the answer of the question from my previous video, which was about dosage calculation. So, I had given you a question for practice. For those who are unaware of my another video, which talks about dosage calculation, you can go there and watch the video, and you can also see the practice question at the end of the video. So, if you are curious about the question for this answer, then you can watch the video. And you can also go through other questions about dosage calculations over there, which might be very helpful for you all. Now, let's have a look to the answer for the previous question. So, in the question, it was given about the KCl, that is potassium chloride, which was dissolved in the NS and which was to be given to the patient. So, we were supposed to find the amount of KCl that is to be dissolved in the NS. So, what we know, like we know the formula, that is desired dose by stock dose multiplied by dilution, or the medicine level, that is the level given in the medicine. Here it is the level that we see in the potassium chloride ampoule. So desired dose here is 30 mEq. This is the dose ordered by the physician. By stock dose means the dose that is in the ampoule, that is in the ampoule we have 40 mEq in 20 ml. So this is by 40 multiplied by, it is in 20 ml, so it is multiplied by 20 ml. So by calculating all this, what we get here is 15 ml. So we need to add 15 ml of potassium chloride in the bottle of NH. So it is also given that the amount of NH and the time period in which the fluid should be administered. If you want to get my free resources and be a part of my online classes, you will need to be subscribed to my channel and you need to fill the form given in the description box below. So fill the form and grab the opportunity.